Good morning.
Yeah.
Lethbridge. How are you guys today?
Good.
Okay, if you are like me and you definitely need a second cup of coffee today, feel free to jump up, grab yourself a refill, grab another donut if you need the sugar rush. It was kind of one of those mornings at our house, and that dreary weather did not help. So hopefully between the caffeine and the sugar and the amazing band, we'll get you guys woken up this morning. We're kicking off a brand new series this morning, and it's going to be a really powerful series. We're talking about how to deal with life's hurts, hang-ups, and it's going to be something that I think each one of us can relate to, but also something that we know people that we can share this with. So I encourage you as you listen today, not only applying to yourself, but also kind of thinking through, who can I share this message with this week as just kind of a tool to share God's hope and his gospel? So I want to encourage you guys, take a moment, stand up, greet one another. If you do need to grab more coffee, do so, and then we're going to worship in just a second.
Morning.
Thank you.
Just like the sunshine, you have been a light, leading us into beautiful places. Just like the fire that you made us bright,
save your numbers, save. Go ahead and you can be seated. So a couple of housekeeping things just for you to be aware of. Something I'm playing with, kind of experimenting with. If you have YouVersion on your phone or the Bible on your phone, I invite you just to go to it. You know, go ahead and have the freedom now to go to your phone, your iPad, whatever it is, and hit that. I'm hitting it on mine. And there's just a new feature here I want you to be aware of that we're just kind of playing with. Now, again, for those of you who, you know, you're not a digital person and you're not, this isn't for you. Just indulge me here. You know, this isn't a new direction we're going that if you're not a part of this, then, you know, you're going to feel like you're missing out. But it's just an added benefit for those of you who use YouVersion. So when you type onto YouVersion or click onto YouVersion, at the bottom, you'll see the little screen, the home, and it gives you the option to read the little buttons. On the very far right, there's one that says more. You click on the more and it takes you down to several things just in order. And on that, there's an events button. You click events, and you do that, and you see your area pops up, Springfield, Missouri. And mine's thinking right now, what's going to happen is there'll come a list of different events in Springfield, Missouri. And you'll find on that one for Northbridge Church. And on that one, you click on there, and it has the notes, and it has all the verses that I'm using for today's sermon, for today's talk. And the reason why that's a good thing, and for those of you who maybe kind of struggle flipping through the scriptures and hunting this verse, hunting that verse, all the passages are there. So you can just go one from the other to the other with that tool. And then it allows you the feature to put your own notes below that verse of things that you think of or things that you hear that you want to keep a hold of. So just playing with that a little bit for myself. You know, if that's a tool for you, if that's helpful to you, by all means, take advantage of it. If it's not, then don't worry about it. File it in the appropriate place. But I want you to be aware of that. Also, too, I wanted just to take a moment to talk about, did you guys hear about that story? And for the record, Glenn doesn't know I'm doing this. I didn't ask his permission to do this. But you guys hear last night about the 15-year-old boy that was lost up in Fairgrove area? You hear about that in the news? He was gone for several hours, last night, I'm tuning in, and what I hear on KY3 is that Greene County Sheriff's Department finds this 15-year-old young man who is autistic, and he was huddled in a field, and so that was part of the story. That wasn't the whole story. The whole story was, he was actually found on Glenn Baxley's property, correct, Glenn? Am I telling that correctly? Across the highway from his property. During the day, the authorities asked the Baxleys for permission to go on their fields and be searching because they knew this young man was somewhere in the property, somewhere in the vicinity, but they didn't know where. Glenn, when he got back from work yesterday, was just like, you know, I can't sit here and know that, you know, this kid's out there alone at night. I got to go out there and try to find him. Well, how long were you searching for? Glenn, was it an hour or so, maybe, and on horseback, Glenn found him and connected, got that kid, and got the authorities there to get him to safety. So they didn't say that at KY3, but Glenn, I just stayed publicly. Good job, man. Good job for you. Thank you for stepping out of your comfort zone there and trying to help somebody. That is a cool thing, cool testimony, cool story. We're starting a new series today. Called Freedom. We're finding freedom today. Through this process, as I was preparing for this talk, it reminded me of a story and a time in my life that I honestly put behind me, a time that I hadn't even thought about until this past week. So I'm in ninth grade, graduating or getting out of ninth grade, going into 10th grade. It's during that summer, and sometime in June or July, on a Friday night, I get a phone call about 7:30 at night, and it was a crank call. They were asking for me. I pick up the phone, or I take the phone, and this person is threatening my life. I mean, just saying terrible, terrible things about what they're going to do to me, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. You know, of course, it was unnerving to me, you know. As a ninth grade boy, I didn't know quite how to process that. My parents, they'd already gone through three teenage boys before me, so for them, you know, it's kind of like, this is par for the course, you know, hey, it's just part of life, Tony, just push, move on, you know, and so didn't rattle them one bit, you know, and so call hangs up, done with that. They call back a couple times that night, finally just leave the phone off, you know, disconnect it. Then 2 or 3 weeks later, and of course, I grew up in a kind of family, and I think some of you probably can relate, and maybe some of you are these people. I grew up with parents that, you know, when it hit 90 degrees, that's when it's time to finally shut the windows and turn on the air, right? But you know, I remember as a kid, hey, in the evening, yeah, so what if the humidity's at 85, you know, points? Who cares? At nighttime, it's going to get to 75 degrees at midnight or 1 in the morning, so, you know, it's cool enough to sleep in that. And so we'd have our windows wide open. And so like 2-3 weeks after this phone call, you know, I'm kind of just starting to get over it in my own psyche. And I don't know, 1 or 2 in the morning, I'm awake just because I'm drowning my sweat at this point. And I hear someone at my window scratching on the window surface. And at first I'm thinking, okay, I'm hearing things. And I'm just kind of let it go. And just the scratching just gets more and more and more. And I finally turn over to, because my back's to the window, and I finally get the gumption, get the courage to look, and I see a silhouette of a person outside of my window. Like, in my mind, I'm thinking they're trying to cut through the window. Obviously, they were just scratching at the window. I mean, I took off like a bolt of lightning into my parents' bedroom. You know, I ran fast to get away from that. Long story short, nothing. It was, you know, some kid, obviously, that was just trying to mess with me, you know, scratching on my window. But let me tell you what that did to a 14-year-old boy. It put me in a prison of fear for 5 or 6 years. You know, for 5 or 6 years, I did not sleep with windows open. I mean, and my parents did not change their protocol about the air conditioning, but I sweltered. You know, I was just in a sweat box all the way up until I was in college. I did not sleep with lights off. I did not sleep. Even I found myself, you know, buying some little, you know, cheap $3 boot knife at the local flea market and putting it under my pillow. Because I had so much fear inside of me about someone trying to get me, you know, someone trying to hurt me. I mean, and I was a prisoner of a self-made prison of fear. And it took years for me to kind of overcome and get through that and punch through that. The reason I share this story is to say for you, if you find yourself trapped in a prison of your own making because of your hurts, habits, or your hang-ups, I say, I understand. I get it. I know what that looks like, and I know what that means. For some of us, we can connect with the term hurts, habits, hang-ups. Maybe for others, these terms would make more sense to you. Negative thoughts, irrational feelings, habitual sin. Maybe those terms are a little bit better descriptive of a template for your life. A template for what you war against in your life. Maybe for some of us, what we're talking about today is just recognizing that there is a shadow to ourself, right? Just as I see myself, there's a shadow me. There's a shadow of who I am. And we, for some of us, need to recognize that there's a shadow self and that life is falling apart around us despite our best efforts. Maybe what I'm describing is a new development in your life that you're just recognizing. Maybe it's been a part of your life, a part of who you are for a long, long time, and you've just accepted it as part of you, right? Well, there's good news, folks. In the next 3 weeks after today, we're going to be looking at what it looks like to find freedom from those hurts, those habits, those hang-ups, from those negative thoughts, those irrational feelings, and those habitual sins that we struggle with. How do we release and recognize and release the shadow self within us? We're going to take a look practically at what that means. And the good news for you that we just start at from ground zero and that just is a mantra that we will use through this whole talk is that Jesus is sufficient and able to restore your mind and renew your life. Jesus can restore your mind, and he will renew your life. Don't believe me. You know, I'm not just a cheerleader talking about this. Look at Jesus' life. He specifically says in the book of John, John chapter 14, verse 27, Jesus is talking, and he says this. He says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." Those come from the lips of Jesus telling us, do not be afraid. Do not let your hearts be troubled. I give to you a peace that no one else can. Paul goes on. I'm convinced Paul dealt with some kind of self-made prison also through his life. I conjecture that it has to do with his past. I think he wrestled with the past of the things that he was a part of and the fact, I mean, you know, we kind of gloss over it, but the reality is Paul was guilty of murder. He was complicit in killing Christians, and now he finds himself as one. That's not something that we get over lightly, if you're a part of that. And he goes on in Philippians 4, verse 7, and he says, the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. I am absolutely convinced those hurts, those habits, those hang-ups, those things that haunt you at night, those things that you struggle with, those things that even you can't tell your own husband or your own wife, that just kind of is a part of your DNA now and you just hung on to for years and years and years, and those things just bring darkness to your life. They bring suffering, they bring misery, they bring struggle. I am convinced that Jesus is all sufficient to renew and to restore your heart, your mind, and your life. I'm absolutely convinced of that. That's what we're going to be talking about the next 4 weeks, of how do we go through the process of expecting it, of experiencing that kind of restoration. Because one of the things I'm convinced of, one of the things I know after 20 years of pastoring, is the solution to life's hurts, habits, and hangups, the solution to dealing with your shadow self, the solution to dealing with habitual sin, is not praying one prayer and having pixie dust put on your head and waving a magic wand over your life and expecting Jesus to just magically and miraculously restore everything immediately. Okay? I am convinced, just from my own experiences and from just observation of helping other folks and walking with other folks through junk, sometimes Jesus healing is a process that happens throughout weeks, months, and even years sometimes. But the cool thing is, with Jesus, that process, you can see movement in the right direction. You see steady growth. So where do we begin? Where do we start at on this? And that's the first question, isn't it? You got this giant hurt, this giant habit, this giant hang up in your life. And it's, you know, that old adage of how do you eat an elephant, right? Where do you even begin with this big thing you've been struggling with for 20, 30, 40 years in your life? It's always been there. How do you deal with this thing? And, you know, like take right out of that adage, where how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. Where do you begin at with this? Well, for us, the beginning point is that we reject something, we accept something. Okay? We confront the lie. We reject the lie and we accept the truth. We confront the lie and we embrace the truth. That's the point that we need to just come to grips with today. Come to grips with right now as we're dealing with habits and hang-ups in our life, things that we don't want to ever talk about, is, folks, I'm telling you, I'm begging to you, I'm pleading with you to confront the lie in your life and embrace the truth. What's the lie, you might ask? Matter of fact, Eric asked me the question, what's the lie? Thank you, Eric. I'm glad you asked that so much. The lie is this. The lie is you've got it under control, right? Hey, this little pet sin that I have, this little foible, this little personality trait, this little thing, it's under control. No one realizes that I'm dealing with it. I have it all wrapped up. That's a lie from the pit of hell. Or maybe the lie is, and this is one where you go, no, I don't believe that. No, who would believe this? But we do. It started back in Genesis. The lie is, I am my own God. And you go, no, I'm not that arrogant to think that. Oh, really? Really? You don't at times say, you know what? It's all about me. At times you don't say, you know, I can control my thing. I can control other people around me. I can control all of my situation. I am the master of my destiny. I'm the master of my fate. I am in charge of everything here. Man, we deal with that lie of believing that we're our own God, and so therefore we can take care of our things, or we, for that matter, can even define our own truth. Hey, for everyone else, this habit is bad, but for me it's good because it settles me down. It keeps me focused. It keeps me calm. It keeps my relationships in order, right? And you define that for yourself. And so we see this lie where we say, I can control my thing, or I can even just control all of life around me because I'm a God. The lie that no one else knows what's going on, or the lie that, hey, my habit, my hang up here, it doesn't affect anyone but me, so who cares? What difference does it make if I'm dealing with this thing here? Because it doesn't hurt anybody else. It's a lie too, isn't it? So The first step in finding freedom in life is to confront the lie for what it is. A lie. A lie. And quit hiding it. Quit, you know, covering it up. Quit speaking for it, or quit, you know, speaking in defense of it and protecting it. And then the second thing we have to do as we're finding freedom in life is embrace the truth. Embrace the truth. You know, there's a lot of truths to embrace here. The first one I would challenge us on is the fact that God does exist, right? Now, you would expect, since you attend a Christian church, you'd expect the preacher to stand up here and say, God exists. That's not any kind of rocket science kind of message, is it? I don't get Preacher of the Year award, do I, Brandon? Because I'm saying, hey, y'all, here's my talk today. God exists. And you'd go, well, I hope you would think that, Tony. I hope that would be something that's kind of rock solid and you've already got that figured out. I hope we as a church have that done. But, you know, it is important for us just to remind ourselves, because I remember a while back ago reading a book called Christian Atheist. It was written by a guy named Craig Groeschel, who, you know, makes a real common sense argument, saying that a lot of times we as Christians, even though we embrace at some point our faith, we oftentimes live our lives with the understanding that there won't be a judgment. We sometimes live our lives as if this is the here and the now, and almost like an atheist, even though we claim there's a God, even though we verbally say there's a God, even though we do some things in our lives to show, you know, such as getting up in the morning, going to church, we do some patterns in our lives to say there's something else out there, but then the practical decisions of our life are lived in such a way that we almost look, someone looking in would go, it's an atheist. That person's an atheist. He doesn't believe there's a judgment. He doesn't believe there's heaven and hell. He doesn't believe that God is watching. He doesn't believe that God is impacting or molding or at work in your life. For us, it is important to remember that God exists. He is here now. Romans chapter 1, verse 20 says this. Just as a reminder about God's existence. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse. From the very beginning, Paul tells us, God's invisible qualities, those things that we can't see and perceive, God has made them known and has revealed them to the world, to us as humans. God shows himself. A second truth, not only that God exists, but what I would argue is an incredible truth for us to just push deep into our lives, is that you matter to God. And again, I don't get Preacher of the Year for saying that. Pretty common message, isn't it? Common, but think about this. Think about the fact that a lot of times when we say that, do we really believe it? Do we really believe that we matter to God? I mean, you get that when God wakes up in the morning, he's thinking of you. Oh, I forgot. God doesn't sleep at night, so he's thinking of you when he's awake, when he's aware. He has you on his mind. And you sit back and go, yeah, Tony. Yeah, I get that. I know that I matter to God. And for many of us, this is a common issue that I find that we struggle with. When we think of God, we think of judgment, don't we? We think of punishment, right? We think of, I better keep myself on the straight and narrow, because if not, you know, thunderbolts from heaven are going to be coming down on me, right? We back it up even with biblical verses. We talk to ourselves, you know, and have this self-talk about God being a God of justice and God being a God of righteousness and God being a holy God without sin and cannot stand sin around him. And let me tell you, all those things are correct. Those are truths from Scripture, right? I'm not preaching against that. That is absolutely correct. But for many of us, that is our only picture of our Father God, of our Heavenly Father. For many of us, we embrace that, and I don't know, it gives us something. I don't know if there's something with our id or our super ego or our ego. I don't know what it is in our minds, but for many of us, we run to that. And that's our identification of God. And so we start looking at him almost as an angry parent, or a parent that's just, you know, that kind of parent that you hear about of, oh, don't wake up dad, or don't talk too loud because dad's reading his paper, because what happens if you interrupt his day, right? We start having this perception of God, and so we gravitate to the passages about his righteousness and his holiness, and those are absolutely correct. I'm not arguing against that. It's clearly in Scripture. But let me tell you that for every passage of Scripture in which God is identified as righteous, punishing sin, I can guarantee you there's 2-3 passages that describe him as the father to the fatherless, as the defender of widows and orphans. Jesus even teaches that his heavenly Father loves creation so much that he will see a common sparrow and count it worthy to take note of. And so I tell you today, if you sit back and you find yourself embracing the idea that God is righteous and holy and he's waiting to strike you down in terror because you cross him in some way, I remind you that if you're awash in anxiety today, the Scriptures say, cast all your cares upon him, for he cares for you. 1 Peter 5:7. If you're burdened with life today, I would tell you that Jesus proclaims to us, come to me, you who are weary and heavy laden. Matthew 11:26. If you find yourself in the middle of crisis and you don't know where to turn to, the Lord will take up your cross, declares Lamentations 3:55. If you're drowning in depression and you don't know where to turn, you don't know where to go to, Nehemiah proclaims, the joy of the Lord is my strength, found in his book, chapter 8, verse 10. If you're paralyzed with fear like I was as a teenager, Jesus tells us in John 14:27, don't be troubled and do not be afraid. If grief grips your life, blessed are you, for you will be comforted, Jesus proclaims. If you're racked with illness and disease, cry out with Jeremiah his prayer, heal me and I will be healed, he proclaims in Jeremiah 17:14. If you find that your family is falling apart, Paul proclaims to us that he will be the father to you in 2 Corinthians 6:18. If you're living in loneliness, the Lord goes with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you, according to Deuteronomy 31:6. If temptation is tormenting you, we have a Savior tempted in every way possible to abandon the cross, in Hebrews 4:14. And I saved this passage for us to read together that just sums it all up for me in my mind as I understand that Jesus, that God the Father is our biggest fan, that God the Father is for us, that he cares for us. And we go to Hebrews, we stay right in Hebrews 4:16. As we see that he has the power to change us and he has the power to grow us. Go ahead and just go there if you have your scriptures open. Hebrews 4:16 says, let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive the mercy and find the grace to help us in our time of need. Many of us folks, the place we have to go to, where do we begin in confronting these hurts, habits, and hang-ups, these habitual sins, these shadow self, as we admit the truth, and as we embrace the God who cares for us, let us go to the throne where there is much grace and much mercy, and let's throw ourselves into that. Into that. So not only do we embrace the truth that God exists, that you matter to God, we also have to embrace the truth that God has the power to change you and your situation. God can change you. God can make a difference in your life. We go to 2 Timothy 1:7. And I would say this, I would say as we read this passage, many of us need to apply 2 Timothy 1:7 into our lives. For God did not give us a spirit of timidity or a spirit of fear, your translation might say, but instead he gave us a spirit of power, of love, and the NIV says self-discipline. Yours might say self-control. Some of you might say a sound mind. God didn't give us a spirit of fear. He didn't give us a spirit of timidity. He didn't give us a spirit of defeat in our lives. But instead, he's given us power and love and self-control. Those are three things I've discovered you need, I need, to defeat any hurt, any habit, any hang-up, to defeat any habitual sin, to defeat any kind of irrational thought or irrational behavior, to confront the shadow self of yourself. You need power, and you need love, and you need self-control in your lives. And so the very first place as we deal with this is we say no to fear, and we surrender to God, and we seek daily his power and love and self-control. Now, I tell you, this is not a one-time experience, right? That's part of the deal with it dealing with, or part of the issue with dealing with your shadow self. You're dealing with hurts and habits and hang-ups. We think, okay, if I pray this prayer about, maybe let's just say bitterness, right? Maybe bitterness has just wracked our lives and just angry with the world around. Someone wronged us in the past, and so you go, okay, you know what? I need to forgive. And so I'm going to pray a prayer of forgiveness. I'm going to ask God to help me forgive person X, Y, or Z. And you pray that prayer, and then you're shocked 3 or 4 minutes later, maybe, or 3 or 4 hours later, or 3 or 4 days later, when you find yourself dealing with that issue still there. And you're like, wait a second, I thought I just prayed about that. Well, what I'm talking about here is not, it's not like a prayer of salvation where you call out to God and God says, okay, it's all done. It's taken care of. Here we go. You know, you call out for salvation. I've given you salvation. Case closed. This is an issue where God, sometimes as I am calling for God to give me power and give me love and give me the self-control to deal with these things, I find that I go to God praying that same prayer multiple times throughout the day, maybe multiple times within that hour. Why? Because as God is pouring his power and his love and his self-control into me, I find that because of life and because of who I am and because I'm made of this physical substance, I tend to leak. And so as power is being poured into me by just dealing with life, that power can leak out of me. And so what I'm saying is that we have to rely upon God, not just one time in our life, but day by day, moment by moment, for his power and his love and his self-control to come into my life and to come into your life. So, the choice is yours. As we check into this topic and talk about this topic, the very first place to start is admitting the truth, admitting the lie, finding the lie, seeing that, and embracing the truth. And so that's your challenge. Now, it's kind of interesting because we did a series 7 years ago. We did a series 7 years ago called Life's Healing Problems. Was that right? Choices, thank you. Life's Healing Choices. And it was like an 8-week or 9-week long series. It was along with a part. Some of you have been around for a while. You remember this because we talked about it in small groups and we had a companion book to go with it. And I'm just going to talk to you now. You know, what I experienced was we really thought this was a powerful tool. The pastors really believed this would be a powerful tool for our church to help people deal with some life hurts. And you know what? Honestly, looking back, after we got it done and we kind of did a post-mortem on it, you know, a few weeks after that, a lot of people disengaged. And we actually saw attendance go down during those 8 weeks, and we discovered that a big part of it was people didn't want to deal with their hurts. People kind of said, hey, you know what? Hey, hands off. Hey, what I feel about my parents, that's between me and my parents, or that's between me and myself, and I don't want to talk about that with you. I don't want you to even ask me probing questions. And I shared this with you to say, for the next 4 weeks, I promise you this, I'm never going to get in your face and pull you in a corner and say, you know, grab you by the shirt collar and say, come on, start dealing with this stuff. I'm never going to do that. You're never going to be singled out, nothing. But we're going to ask some probing questions. We're going to challenge you in some ways. And I'm going to ask for you as a congregation not to disengage, not to say, hey, this is getting a little personal here. This is starting to hit where I live, so I'm going to kind of mentally check out here. And I just challenge you today, this very moment. You know, are you prepared when you're dealing with your habit, your hurt, your hang-up, are you prepared to admit the lie that you're living under and embrace the truth? Because here's the thing. The cool thing about this is a cool thing. All of us here are in the same boat, folks. If you don't think you have a hurt or a hang-up of some kind in your life, wow, I've met the Messiah. Jesus is here. If you're saying, oh, no, got everything's good with me, Tony, we're all in the same boat. We're all in the same boat. And so the question I close today with, power, love, self-control. Do you need to go to God today and say, God, I'm claiming that verse in my life. I'm asking you to pour those things into me as I deal with my thing, as I deal with this issue, as I deal with this thing that's holding me back or this thing that's kind of chained me up a little bit. What do you need? What do you need from God today? Let's pray. And I just, just ask you the question here. Just, again, no embarrassment, nothing to cause you any kind of flustering or anything like that, but just a show of hands. Who here? I'm going to pray right now. I'm praying for myself that God would just pour into my life his power, his love, his self-control. Who here would say, Tony, I'm right there with you. I need God's power, love, and self-control in my life. I need that because I need to confront some hurts and habits and hang-ups. I need to deal with my shadow self, and I've just been ignoring it. I need a dose of God's power, love, and self-control. Okay, I see quite a few hands up. You're not alone, friends. You're not alone in this. Pray with me. Father, we come before you, and we admit the lie. We admit, God, we know we're not God. We know we're not you. We know we don't control circumstances and life around us. And God, we get that our hurts and habits and hang-ups, they impede us from walking with you and giving and experiencing the freedom that you so desperately desire for us. And God, we get that our shadow self and our habitual issues, our habitual sins, our irrational fears, all of those things, those influence and those affect our closest relationships and the people we love the most in our lives. So would you pour into our lives today your power, that we'd have the strength to deal with these things, your love. Because God, as we replace some habits and replace some things, as we get rid of some things, we need to replace them with your love. And God, we need self-control. We live in a world, we live in a culture, we live in an age that says that I should get whatever I want and I should get it now. So teach us self-control, Father, with our lives, with our minds, with our bodies, with our relationships, with our checkbooks, with how we do time, with all aspects of our lives. These things I pray in your Son's powerful name. Amen. I invite you to stand to your feet and join in the song here. Just let this song be kind of an amen to what we've talked about today.
Sing with me, guys. raised to life, our God is able. In his name we overcome, for the Lord our God is able. Raised to life, our God is able. In his name we overcome, for the Lord our God is able. Lifted up, he defeated the grave. Raised to
God is able. Amen.
Amen.
You know, I want you to hear what Tony's heart said today, and that is you do not face anything that is too big for our God. And I hope that you feel that today. But if you are wrestling with that and you're struggling with that truth, I want to encourage you in a couple of different ways. I want to encourage you to use your connection card kind of as a tool to communicate with your pastors and your leadership team. Number one, if you're not comfortable talking to somebody yet, but you're saying, man, I do recognize a hurt or a hang up or a habit that I need to deal with, I just want to invite you to jot that down on your connection card. Drop it in the brown box over there, the wooden box, and just let us come beside you in a spirit of prayer over these next 4 weeks. And if you're maybe ready to say, you know what? I don't just need prayer. I need to wrestle with this. I've been wrestling with it a long time, and enough is enough. And you just need to sit down. You need to talk to somebody. I encourage you, either grab somebody. John's here, Tony, myself, one of your small group leaders, and just tell them, hey, I need help. I need to talk to somebody about this. If you can't grab somebody today, write that on your connection card, and we will connect you with a member of our connection team to walk beside you, to talk with you, and to pray with you through these next few weeks. You guys, there is so much freedom available in the love of Christ, and I hope that you experience that, not just today, not just in this series, but for the rest of your lives. Also, use your connection card. There's a couple of announcements that we can have you communicate back with us. We're going to be updating our picture directory, our member directory, over the next few weeks. If you need pictures taken for that, you can sign up at the connection table as well. We're going to be doing those next week and the following week. And then also on the 24th, we're going to be doing a Discovering Northbridge luncheon. So if you're new to Northbridge, you'd like to learn a little bit more about our leadership, how we do church here, kind of our structure, we invite you to join us for lunch that day. You can sign up for that either at the connection table or on your connection card as well. You guys are dismissed. Have a great day.